So all we need is time.
The stuff I saw yesterday wouldn't have worked. It wasn't impressive enough.
You're so full of beans. None of it's impressive. Yeah. What are you impressed with?
Do you take this and actually make something big out of it? Or do you just play around and, you know, do little lessons here and there?
Do you stand and ask this question over and over and over again? Or
what he's talking about is making money. Let the girl talk.
Miles, he managed the biggest and most successful band of the 80s, the Police.
Stop filming on me, buddy.
By the time my eyes blinked open, he'd already decided he was not a musician, he was a purveyor of music.
Arabic music is very, very infectious and uplifting music.
Somewhere along the line, figured out he couldn't make it himself, but he could sure package it.
But it's not necessarily something that you could go to an American audience and say, come and see an Arab music show.
Miles grew up in the Middle East. His father was with the OSS, which is the precursor to the CIA. His father is very, very famous.
I kind of took the analogy of river dance, where they took Irish music and Irish dance, and I noticed that sales of Irish music really increased after river dance. So you thought, interesting.
Hi, I'm here to try to raise money for a project that will track the history and evolution of walking and talking. As you can see by these examples, walking and talking is difficult. We are human beings. We have two legs. Unlike our four-legged friends, we've made really the best possible use of our physiology when it comes to walking and talking.
In 1900, the average life expectancy was 50 years. You know what it is now? 77 and a half and counting. Now, some of you probably think that's a wonderful thing. You're the same group of people who thought they were going to change the world and ended up in the health club. Now you find yourselves running on a treadmill like someone's chasing you, and nothing scares you like a cheeseburger. What is wrong with you people?
That's Earl. He was just a sad picture on the web with one day to live at some kill center in South Carolina where they don't have anti-cruelty laws. Hey, now we can hang a bag of puppies on a fence so the kill center can find them and kill them. People. That's his about to meet someone posture. I wish I could be that interested in others of my species. I wonder what he wants. A little whiff of ass and off he goes, pulling it all in through that mighty part beagle nose of his. That anus must be like Facebook for him, full of history and information. Just like us, he can experience others without having to put in the time. I wonder if life imagined seems better than life itself, for all species, occasionally. Come on, let's go home and watch some TV.
Because of their rather restrictive door policy, our agents were not able to get in.
Ultimately, even the velvet rope proved to be insufficient in stopping the Internal Revenue Service. At 9:30 on the morning of December 14, 1978, the unconquerable Studio 54 was raided. Shortly thereafter, Ian Schrager showed up as he always did.
As he was going upstairs, one of the agents said he forgot his mail, and he picked it up. He found an envelope that contained cocaine. We called down the U.S. Attorney's Office, got permission from Mr. Sutler, we got a warrant, and we arrested him.
And then Roy Cohn walks in.
He was present on the day of the raid, having been called, I guess, by Rubel or Schrager.
And all of a sudden, the face on these guys that were ordering us around dropped, and they're like, oh, and he just said, what? They won't. You go wherever you want, blah, blah, blah. And it was like, yeah, you know, now my backup's here.
It was not in his briefcase. They do not allege it was in his briefcase. I've read the complaint, and I was in court, and you weren't.
The American dream is dead.
The world is a mess. The world is as angry as it gets. Well, you think this is going to cause a little more anger? The world is an angry place. All of this has happened. The world is a total mess. The world is a mess. I could be the most presidential person but I may not be able to do the job nearly as well if I do that.
I don't know what I said.
Donnelly, just get off the bus.
Like a little
okay,
hug,
absolutely.
They call him elite. My education's better than any of them.
I'm smarter than they are, many of the people. No.
And then I got here. I had no idea. You gotta wonder, why would this be this instead of something else? Every day, you choose what to wear, which way to go, what to be, what to say, who to know, what to want. You have these lives, every one of you. Why? I mean, there you are, inexplicably, these living sacks of fluid and bone and brains with lifespan and inevitable death. And you just turn up on this planet spinning in an incomprehensible universe that you believe started somehow, for some reason, at one particular moment. Scale like that, can anything make any difference? Or does every last little thing matter in unimaginable ways? What is all this? I'm an alien, and I don't really get it. So what I do all day long is just watch and wonder why. Oh, this is Earl. He's, I guess, my sidekick. We've been at this now for a long time, but you people are puzzling. I have so many questions.
Film and television are gathering around robots, AI, cyber conflict, and space travel because these things are happening or being planned now. But this is just the beginning of an epic narrative.
In the lifetime of people alive today, human beings will be taking control of their own evolution.
Throughout history, the future has been abstract and unknowable. But today, many great minds are convinced that in the lifetimes of most of us, science and technology will forge a new kind of augmented human being.